Well, I suppose you could say that artificial intelligence, AI for short, started really in the 50s, the 1950s. And in those days, and that's when I first encountered it in the late 50s, in those days, people, I think, weren't primarily interested, and many people weren't interested at all, I think, in how it could be useful in terms of, commercial applications and so on. Although people were already starting to work on machine translation, and that's how I first came across it. But they wanted to use it to think about how the mind works. And they were hoping, I think it's fair to say, to come up with a general theory of thinking or problem solving, which would not only rest on what was known and obviously elaborate on what was known about how humans solve problems, but could be applied generally to virtually any problem. And right at the beginning, two things happened which actually made that seem a reasonable goal. One was, I think it was 1956, a man called Arthur Samuel in the States wrote a program for playing draughts, or checkers, as he as an American called it, which not only played checkers well, which is fine, but what was really interesting is that a couple of years later, it learnt to play better than Arthur Samuel himself. So that, if you like, was the first intimation, actually in practice, not just a theoretical vision, but in practice, that AI systems might equal, possibly even surpass, certainly equal human intelligence. And then only perhaps a year or so later, there was another such thing that happened. A program called the Logic Theorist was written by Newell and Simon. Which did logic problems and was able to solve to find a very large number of the logical theorems that had been proved in Bertrand Russell's Principia Mathematica, Russell and Whitehead, Principia Mathematica. And in one case, it found a more elegant proof than Russell had himself. And I mean, that was really extraordinary because whereas Samuel was just an ordinary, moderately competent draughts player, Russell was a world-leading logician. If this thing could find something that, was more elegant proof than he had done, that really made people sit up and think, wow. The next, I mean, just a few years later, the next sort of big step was a program called the General Problem Solver, and the clue there is in the name, the General Problem Solver. The idea was that if you could represent a problem in the sorts of terms, broadly speaking, goals and sub-goals and actions for making certain changes, if you could represent a problem in the sort of way that was required by this program, then all the reasoning could be left to the program. And it was thought that this could apply to any problem. And again, it was initially really quite impressive. I mean, not just that it could be done at all, which in those days was remarkable, but that it could do some apparently quite difficult things. For example, there was a puzzle called the Missionaries and Cannibals problem. Three missionaries and three cannibals on one side of the river, a boat that will carry no more than two people. How do you get everybody over to the other side of the river without ever having a situation in which cannibals outnumber missionaries? And actually, that is difficult because it requires a backward step at one point. And this thing managed to suss that out. It wasn't told it required a backward step, it found it. So that was all fine, and people were full of hope. But then it quite quickly became clear that actually, for real problems, real world problems, as opposed to puzzles like Missionaries and Cannibals, you normally need quite a lot of world knowledge. So, for example, if you've got medical problems, medical diagnosis, or prescribing drugs, you need to know quite a bit about the disease, about the drugs, and so on. or if you want to do stuff in chemistry, you need to know quite a lot about chemistry. So people started then writing not general programs, but so-called expert systems, which were devoted to, you know, a particular area and could be practically very, very useful to people working in those areas. Nowadays, there are literally thousands of these things. I mean, they're not called expert systems anymore. Some of them are called apps.